Almighty Allah, who is most beneficent and merciful to us. Today, I'm going to discuss 18th Amendment in Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan 1973, whereby and then President surrendered his powers on the pretext that true federal parliamentary form of government be restored and the unbridled powers vested with the president under Article 58(2)(b) as the president was empowered through the 8th Amendment to dissolve the government and the assemblies. Let us first discuss the background through which 8th Amendment was introduced. It was during the regime of General Muhammad Zia-ul Haq, who took over reins of powers after controversial elections of era of Mr. Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto, leader of the Pakistan People's Party, in the year 1977. Who was later on tried in a case and was sent to gallows through a very controversial judgments. However, when the martial law was imposed by General Zia-ul Haq, the Chief Martial Administrator, in the year 1977, his actions were challenged by Motilal Nusrat Bhutto, and that case is reported in PLD 1977 Supreme Court 657. Although afterwards, through referendum process of 1984 and amendment in the constitution was brought, in 1985, although whenever martial law is imposed in the country, the provisional constitution order is implemented, which is an extra constitutional measure and is not postulated in the constitution, but in the supreme national interest, when the democratic governments are not functioning properly. The first victim of the infamous 8th Amendment was that of government of Muhammad Khan Junejo, who had become the Prime Minister of the country in the year 1985 after general elections, that too on non-party basis. But before completion of 5 years tenure, in the year 88, that government was dismissed and assemblies were dissolved. Similarly, situation occurred when General Zia-ul Haq, along with 26 others, died in a plane crash near Bahawalpur, and general elections were got conducted in the country. Motarmam Benazir Bhutto, after winning the election, took over the powers and formed the government. However, in the meanwhile, through a revival of constitution order of 1985, the 8th amendment, which was got passed through that assembly of non-party basis, Muhammad Khan Junejo was given protection. But it was certainly part and parcel of the constitution, vesting the president with the powers that he is not bound to act on the advice of the prime minister or the cabinet if any such like measure is expedient and necessary. This was the scenario. So Ghulam Ishaq Khan was the president of Islamic Republic of Pakistan in the year 1990, when he too dismissed the government of Motarmam Benazir Bhutto. And this kind of situation prevailed in this country till 2010. And in the meanwhile, as you people are aware of the fact that after the general elections of 1990, again Muslim League Nawaz came into power, and Mian Nawazi was the Prime Minister of Pakistan, but his government was also dismissed before completion of 5 years tenure as postulated in the Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan, and that order was also challenged. I'll refer those judgments. So twice by the President Ghulam Ishaq Khan, who was of course not a military dictator but a civilian president. Subsequently, in 1996, after the general elections of 1993, again Motarmam Benazir Bhutto became the Prime Minister of Pakistan second time, but his government was also dismissed by Sardar Farooq Ahmad Khan Lahari, then President of Pakistan. So the again after the general elections of 1997, Mian Nawaz Sharif took over the powers, and then there is a coup d'etat of 12th of October 1999, and General Pervez Musharraf took over the powers as the Chief Marshal Administrator. And then later on, after the general elections of 2008, consensus was built up by the President Asif Zardari and his cabinet as they were ruling the country, the federal government, as well as in the province of Sindh. So in this situation, a committee of 26 members was constituted by a stalwart political leader, Mr. Raza Rabbani, and long discussion and deliberation were carried on for this purpose and objective, enabling and making the recommendation for not only this main power of 58 to be the removal of the same from the constitution, so and to provide strength to the democratic institution, as well as revival of the Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan 1973 in its original form. So on the basis of the recommendation that 58(2)(b) powers, although Mr. Asif Ali Zardari was the president of Islamic Republic of Pakistan, but he opted to surrender those powers for strengthening the federal parliamentary form of government. So this was the scenario, and similarly, not only the Article 58(2)(b), but some other amendment which we had all been introduced during the lot many previous governments. So those were also got rid of, and some deletion and additions were made in the Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan. There is a long list of those provisions as contained in the 18th amendment, which was got passed through Parliament, both the houses, and by National Assembly and the Senate, and then the consent of its insertion in the Constitution was given by President Asif Ali Zardari. So, in the let me first refer here the name of former President of Pakistan, General Zia-ul Haq, was removed from the text of Constitution. As you know, the name of province NWFP, North West Frontier Province, for the change of the same, Pashtun majority was making a long-lasting demand. So, through the 18th Amendment, that NWFP province was renamed as Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. In the same fashion, there was some confusion in the spelling of Balochistan. Instead of letter U, O was inserted. Likewise, Sindh was being spelled S-I-N-D, the letter H was added in the same. It is, you know, earlier to 18th Amendment, an effort was, was made, which was successful, and through 13th Amendment, during that stint of Muslim League, as Mian Nawaz Sharif was the Prime Minister of Pakistan, in the 1997 to 1999, through 13th Amendment, 8th Amendment was also removed from the Constitution. But later on, when Mr. Pervez Musharraf had taken over the powers of the country and the political party was also put at place, that was a semi, you know, kind of parliamentary and presidential system run the affairs of the state. Through 17th Amendment, that 13th Amendment was scrapped. In result thereof, the 8th Amendment had been restored again. So this was the whole, you know, background and eventualities which was taking place in the country. So this was the main reason of bringing 18th Amendment. Because twice, you know, Motiram Benazir Bhutto had become the Prime Minister of Pakistan, although failed to complete her both the tenures. This similar situation occurred with the Governor Mian Nawaz Sharif twice. So, and therefore, the ban of third time premiership was also, you know, was lifted. So they were in a position through 18th Amendment to contest the election third time. That is why after the in the general election 1997, that again from the year 2013 to 2018, Mian Nawaz Sharif was in a position to form the government, and that was his third stint as Prime Minister. This was due to that 18th Amendment, which was introduced and made the part and parcel of the Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan during the Pakistan People Party government. You know, chartered in the when they were in the opposition, and Pervez Musharraf was ruling the country. then they had also developed a consensus, you know, the name and style of Charter of Democracy. So they were conscious of this sort of situation and exercise of the power by the president through the 8th Amendment for dismissal of their government and the dissolution of assembly, as they had previously experienced, you know, number of times rather. It was similarly, another provision was inserted holding constitution abeyance is tantamount to high treason. Well, earlier whenever the martial law was imposed in the country, you know, to bring a safety wall so that this kind of power may not be exercised again, it was held that if now to onward, if the constitution is abrogated, subverted and held in abeyance, then the whoever does so and the, you know, and their aider would be subjected to trial under the, you know, High Treason Act 1976, as well as under Article 6 of the Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan. So this and it would be termed to be high treason. The Council of, because earlier, you know, there's a Council of Common Interest being headed by Prime Minister of Pakistan to resolve the dispute and misgiving between the provinces and in the larger interest of the country. So it was also mandated through the 18th Constitution that when now on the regular basis the meetings of Council of Common Interest shall be convened, and at least once in 90 days. Similarly, regarding recommendations were made for National Finance Commission. In the chapter of judicature, as postulated under Article 175 of the Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan, with respect to elevation and appointment of the judges of the superior courts, it was also reframed by inserting 175A. Whenever the name of any aspirant is recommended by the for elevation of any advocate and judges from our tiers, then that process will be examined through the Judicial Commission of Pakistan. So there was a, you know, 9-member commission in the aftermath of it, the amendment, and the significant, you know, members, certainly Chief Justice of Pakistan is the chairman of the Judicial Commission, 2 senior most judges of the Supreme Court were members, 2 senior most chief justices of the respective high courts are the members, the Attorney General of Pakistan, Federal Law Minister, member of a nominee of the Pakistan Bar Council, likewise, and that of the Bar Council. And then further, under Article 175A, the names recommended by the Judicial Commission shall also be scrutinized by the Parliamentary Commission, that too is, you know, comprises of members of the ruling party and the leader of the opposition, as well as other members. So if it would be endorsed and consent is given, then the process of appointment, the judge of the Superior Court is finalized. You know, the position under the provision of the Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan for the Chief Election Commission, which is certainly a constitutional entity, and it has also been agreed through the 18th Amendment that whenever the Chief Election Commission shall be appointed for a particular tenure, and probably it is article, if I'm not forgetting, 213, 214 is the relevant article of the constitution. He will be appointed with consensus by the prime minister and the leader of the opposition, so that and transparency and independence of the incumbent chief election commission be ensured in letter and spirit. So this is that change has also certainly taken place through the 18th amendment. Well, Islamabad High Court was established during that period, and it was also stipulated in the 18th amendment that the Islamabad High Court should be set up, as well as some benches of high courts in Mingora and Turbat, in the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. It was also reiterated in the 18th amendment with respect to protection of the children's rights, with reference to the fact that every child, girl or boy, is having a guaranteed right to free education in the category of the age falling between 5 years to 16 years. Another very important, and that is provided under Article 25B, probably. There is a freedom of expression as guaranteed under Article 19 of the, Chapter 2 of the Constitution of Islamic Pakistan, with reference to fundamental rights of the citizen of the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. There is a long list of those fundamental rights. And amendment was also brought under Article 19A of the Constitution of Islamabad, having great nexus and relevance with that freedom of speech, right to having the access of information to every citizen of Pakistan regarding any public government department. On the same, because on the same analogy, Right to Information Act 2013 was also introduced and promulgated in the province of Punjab, which is still in vogue. For the sake of repetition, because that is the pivotal point with respect to the scrapping of the powers of the President of Islamic Republic of Pakistan to dissolve the assemblies under Article 52B. Again, what is the tenor of Article 48, whereby in the original Constitution of Islamic Republic of Pakistan, it has been envisages that if any situation or emergency has arisen in the country warranting that dismissal of the government, then only the advice of the Prime Minister and the Cabinet shall be sought. If the Prime Minister in the office is conscious of the fact that he has lost the confidence of majority members of the Parliament, so that situation has restored. President is no more is at liberty to exercise the power under Article 58(2)(b) by using his own discretion and reasons, as in the supreme national interest, he can dissolve the assemblies, as it happened many times. The number of the members were also enhanced from earlier, North House of is comprised of 342 members. Earlier, the number was quite less. Similarly, the members of the Senate were enhanced, 104, and four from each province, one from each province would be the member of the Senate from the minorities, from the non. This change has been brought through this very amendment. Another very significant aspect of the matter, this numerous many ministries at federal level were devolved to the provincial government. And you know, because of as I have said, normally the nowadays controversy has arisen between the government at place in the federal government and the particularly government at the scene, because that is of the Pakistan Socialist Party. And you know, on electronic media, it is nowadays it has become very common that they, because they are leveling allegation of bad governance and misgovernance and law and order situation and corruption in the respective province. So there will also be amendment in the 18th, and rather if it is not scrapped in its entirety to some extent. And that too is, you know, because of the far and against debate and their own strong reasons. As many ministries have already been devolved along with their respective assets, so I refer here as contained in the Constitution of Islam Republic of Pakistan. Ministries like Ministry of Education is part of, at federal level, Ministry of Federal Education and Professional Training, because the education is considered to be the provincial subject. Ministry of Archaeology and Culture now is Ministry of Culture. Ministry of Environment now Ministry of Climate Change. Ministry of Health now Ministry of National Health Services and Regulation. Rather, in this way, the earlier ministries have been narrowed down, their scope has been narrowed down, and those have been curtailed at federal level. Rather, these are considered to be the provincial subject. Ministry of Special Interior abolished, that has been altogether abolished at the federal level. Ministry of Labour and Manpower now has been renamed Ministry of Overseas Pakistani and Human Resources Development. So that too has been curtailed. Ministry of Local Government and Rural Development has been entirely abolished at federal level. Ministry of Monetary Affairs merged with the Ministry of Religious Affairs. Earlier it was considered to be the independent ministry. Now it has been merged into Ministry of Religious Affairs. Ministry of Population Welfare altogether has been removed and abolished at federal level. Ministry of Social Welfare and Special Education has too been abolished at federal level. Ministry of Sports now is termed to be the Pakistan Sports Board at federal level, and rather has been given to the provincial. Ministry of Tourism given to Pakistan Tourism Development Corporation, another autonomous body instead of its full-fledged entity of ministry as it was earlier. So my main objective was through this 18th amendment to lessen the burden of at the exchequer of the federal level. Ministry of Women Development stood abolished at federal level. Ministry of Youth Affairs abolished at federal level. Ministry of Zakat and Usur abolished at federal level, now given to provinces. So this was the whole scenario. But through that 8th amendment, another very important headway was made when through that amendment Article 2A was introduced, and the objective resolution of 1949 was made part and parcel of the Constitution, which is still intact because of it was stipulated through that Quran and Sunnah, the supreme law of the country, as contemplated under Article 227 as well. So that is in the Constitution. It was also inserted because it is relevant to the judiciary. The judiciary shall be separated from the executive. Well, that truth judicial of the case of 1989, and then the federal government went in appeal, then ultimately in 1993 that clause was removed, further in 1985 through the 8th Amendment. So that is still in existence. So last but not the least, for my friends in the legal fraternity, lawyers, judges, particularly who are aspiring to appear in the competitive exam, because in keeping in view this comparative study of 8th Amendment as well as 18th Amendment with all its nitty-gritty and intricacies, it would be better for them to read some of the judgments available in our law journal on this constitutional development which have taken place in the aftermath of 8th Amendment and till 2010, when this 18th Amendment, through the 18th Amendment, that 8th Amendment was removed. Well, first of all, regarding the dismissal of the government of Mohammad Khan in 1988 and certainly dissolution of both assemblies, first of all, by the general, then President General Jawaharlal. So it is, reported in, that is, Federation of Pakistan versus Haji Saifullah Khan, PLD 1989, Supreme Court 166. Although through writ petition, he was also a member of the National Assembly, and he challenged that action of 58, exercise of power by the President under Article 58(2)(b), and relief was granted when he filed a writ petition by the Honorable Lahore High Court. But the government was not restored. Action was declared illegal, and that was the scenario. Because in the meanwhile, in 88, through the general election of 1988, in the meanwhile, till the decision of that very case, Mohammad Benazir Bhutto and Pakistan People's Party was able to form the government. But when both the parties challenged this matter before the Honorable Supreme Court, and then it was examined on the touchstone of Article 184(3), whether it can be termed to be the and construed to be the matter of public importance. So this brief resume. Another very interesting case, that is in the aftermath of dismissal of the government of Mohammad Benazir Bhutto in the year 1990 by then President Ghulam Isaak Khan. The case was filed in the original jurisdiction of the Honorable Supreme Court of Pakistan with title Khwaja Ahmad Tariq Rahim versus Federation of Pakistan, reported in PLD 1992 Supreme Court 646. After the general elections, the Pakistan Muslim League took over the powers, and that government was also dismissed by then President Ghulam Isaak Khan by exercising his powers under Article 58(2)(b). And that that case is titled Mohammad Nawaz Sharif versus President of Pakistan, reported in PLD 1993 Supreme Court 473. Although relief was granted by the Honorable Supreme Court of Pakistan, a large bench was constituted in this regard. but despite the restoration of the assemblies and government of university, the interregnum some situation had erupted, and both of them were shown the doors, not only university but President Ram Sahib. Then, after the 12th of October 1999, and that hijacking case was alleged hijacking matter, is another long story which requires much time to discuss. But the leader of the Pakistan Muslim League, Syed Zafar Ali Shah, challenged the actions of General Pervez Musharraf of 12th of October 1999, and that matter is reported in PLD 2000 Supreme Court 869. So these cases of our constitutional history are very important and required to be go through by the particularly my focus and my services, and this humble effort is for the incumbent in this profession, especially those lawyers who intend to appear for the competitive examination of judicial officers. Thank you very much.